I don't know what time it is. I don't know how on the record we are, but Mike Hearn. Mike Hearn, who is one of the preeminent core developers in the Bitcoin community, who works for R3. It'll be in the New York Times any minute, has broken up with Bitcoin today. He said it's a failed experiment. And he believes that the future state for this technology, the distributed ledger and blockchain state, can be divorced from the technology and, in fact, needs to be successful.
I mean, I don't understand how Amir, you can say people aren't allowed to participate. I mean, look, this was all born out of a paper that was written in 2008. And the paper, great paper, but to implement something like this is just not going to happen. Quite frankly, I think the whole thing's kind of silly.
But it's working. And it's working. Hang on.
To implement something over the computer, some new currency, and you think that all of a sudden this is going to take off, that's a pipe dream. That is just not going to happen, even though some of these things that you're saying might be true. There might be elements of it that are true.
Okay.
You're just talking nonsense. Jeff?
Paul, what is your opinion of disruptive digital currencies such as Bitcoin? Do they in any way refute the idea that a currency must be backed by a government?
Okay. yeah, actually, at this point, Bitcoin is not looking too good. And then you have somebody try and create Bitcoin, which is, there's nothing in the end. It's supposed to be purely self-fulfilling prophecy, purely meditating on itself, which is not impossible, but it's kind of unlikely.
And wouldn't the world be more efficient if individuals could deal directly in financial terms, much as they do in other markets? The reality, though, is that when you're transferring value, instruments of value, essentially money, you need to have trusted centralized institutions that are accountable for the consequences of how that happens, the implications for not permitting money laundering or terrorist financing, which, of course, if you allow anonymous exchanges of value over the internet, is a big problem.
I think some people were looking for something and they bought into it and literally bought into it for a while. It's not collapsed quite well. So no, the idea that there's something fundamental. I mean, if you're looking for the idea that a currency doesn't really have to be something physical, it can be something that's virtual, that's the system we already have. You know? And if you want it to be, I want a way to make payments electronically, that's, credit cards. I mean, so exactly what it is that this thing is supposed to be doing that we don't already mostly do.
I mean, this is a speculative bubble in a currency which doesn't exist, which has been invented by someone who we don't know, doesn't seem to be run by anybody. So it's just a game that people play. I mean, it's almost
and
like...
And it's the only thing. It's got no assets underneath. There's nothing standing behind it.
And apparently it's worth a lot of money.
Well, I don't think I'm going to go there. I don't know if you are, John.
Well, buying frenzy is... There's no doubt about that. Digital payments are the future. Bitcoin is not that. Bitcoin is a step along the way and will eventually disintegrate and atrophy. But yes, digital currencies and digital payments are the future.
The argument, though, for cash, electronic cash, has been that a lot of that can get moved around, too. The whole secrecy that goes into Bitcoin was that, people can use this for untoward reasons without being tracked by the government.
So you have to play whack-a-mole with all... these things. And so there are always going to be these other things, gold coins, uncut diamonds, now Bitcoin. But as long as you can't go spend them at the store, take them to the bank.
But they just... I mean, with Bitcoin, that's the difference. People use it for their rent. They can buy all kinds of things online.
It's a very low scale now, and you can't go into the drugstore and use it. And they'll prevent it in the future. They're, allowing innovation.
But there would be entrepreneurs who would kind of run a shadow economy system based on Bitcoin. So how would you see that play
it's
out?
Not, it's just not going to happen. You're wasting your time. So you think when the DOJ calls someone up and says that's an illegal currency and it's against the laws of the United States of Atlanta, if you do it again, we'll put you in jail, it's over. So you really don't take a vision. There will, this is my personal opinion, there will be no real non-controlled currency in the world. There's no government that's going to put up with it for long. It's kind of cute now. You know, a lot of the senators and congressmen say, I support Silicon Valley innovation. There will be no currency that gets around government controls.
Anybody here want to take an opposite view? Anybody here want to take an opposite view?
Hi, everybody. Edward here from renegadeinvestor.co.uk. And today we're going to be talking about why I personally believe that the Bitcoin price has good potential of hitting all-time highs in 2016, and why we are about to begin the next stage of this bull market that could take the Bitcoin price well beyond the highs last seen in late 2013.
Because during this massive decline, people were saying, this is the end of Bitcoin, Bitcoin's dead. There's been about 105 articles written now saying that Bitcoin is dead. And each time they say it, Bitcoin just comes back stronger and stronger. So at the moment, I'm extremely bullish on Bitcoin. I think it's going to finish the year around $1,000.
There is a really solid case that Bitcoin in 2016 offers one of the best risk-reward perspective investment opportunities in human history. At a point in time where there has never been so much risk on a global scale in the legacy financial system. And in terms of using Bitcoin as one potential way to protect yourself and prosper from this, in 2016, I don't believe anyone has yet missed the boat with Bitcoin.